That brings us to stereotype, prejudice, and discrimination. And I want to make some distinctions between these terms because they're important. Stereotypes are categories. They're general categories. You can make stereotypes about me, right? You can look at me and say, well, he's a long-haired white male with a tie. I'm not sure what to do about that. I don't really have a stereotype for that. Most people have a stereotype for long-haired white male. As we said before, not necessarily a positive one. Some people might have a positive one. Others have a stereotype for short-haired white male with a tie on. But very few people have a category that fits long-haired white male with tie. In other words, it violates some stereotypes. And assumptions then are harder to make. Because the stereotype is the schema that guides our judgment. It's the category we use to judge the world around us. Some stereotypes can be positive. So you might think, well, this group is always, insert your positive characteristic here, and they also can be very negative. This group's always like, you insert your group and you insert your characteristic. You got to be careful to realize, and I'm going to be pointing this out, it isn't about the validity of this. It's about human beings, the validity of the judgments. The judgments are almost by definition invalid. You can't paint a broad brush across a group and apply that to any individual. Think about yourself for a moment. You're a member of a group. You're a member of an ethnicity. You're a member of a sex group. You're a member of an age group. You're a member of a geographical group. You're probably a member of some kind of political group. You're probably a member of some kind of religious group. And all those things are labels. And then you think to yourself, are you exactly like everybody else in that group? Or do you differ in some significant and individual and unique ways? And you wouldn't want people to take their label that they have, positive or negative. Well, you might take their positive, but you certainly wouldn't want their negative label to be applied to you as an individual, because it wouldn't apply necessarily to you as an individual. It would be a schema-based judgment that you're laying on somebody based on their membership in a group. And that's essentially what you have with stereotype. So stereotypes then will lead to prejudices. Prejudices is an unjustified negative attitude towards an individual based on that person's membership in a group. So we then take those categories and we apply them to people like they are valid. So, oh, they're one of those. I know all about those. And those put your group in there. You know you have biases. You know you have stereotypes. You know you have negative groups that you think exist in this world. Whether you want to admit that or not is a different question. Admitting it is the first step to fixing it. Because what happens is we have in-groups and we have out-groups. And that is the way it is. In-groups are the people we feel affiliated with. Out-groups are them. Them are people we usually don't trust or we tolerate. We tolerate them. And it can be concocted so simply. Research has shown us the minimal group paradigm. You can put people together randomly. And within an hour, they've formed some negative opinions about another group that's been formed randomly without any real information about them. That's powerful. I'll give you an example I saw once. I go to UT games because my wife loves UT, Tennessee Vols. Now me, I'm sports neutral. I like sports. I'm glad people do sports. I enjoy watching people do their thing, and I can get into almost anything. When I go to watch Little League sports, if I don't have a kid on the team, then I'm from whatever team is behind, and as soon as they get ahead, I'm for the other team. I just want people to have a good time doing what they do. But I go to a sporting event, I get into it. I yell. I like to have a good time. And I was sitting there at this UT game in Neyland Stadium, which has a lot of people in orange in it. And I'm sitting in some seats that a friend gave my wife tickets to, which were season ticket seats. And behind us are a bunch of people with season tickets, which means they have some disposable income because those are not cheap, right? So we know something about these people. We could put a stereotype on them, perhaps, but let's not do that. All I know is these people may have gone to this school. They may be college educated. They may not. They may have borrowed tickets like I did. But they're sitting there watching this game with us. And they seem like nice people. Everybody's having a good time. And then all of a sudden you have this guy who walks out of the little chute that goes back under the stands. And he walks out and he looks up. And it's an older fella. He's probably in his 40s or 50s. I'm basing that on the gray hair that he had. And he's wearing a Florida Gators shirt. And people start booing this man. They start chanting and they start throwing epithets at him. They start cussing at him. And the people behind me, who I just happen to be close enough to hear, are saying, man, what an ass. He can't believe he did that. And he's sitting there. He's committed the crime of being them. All he's done at this point is wear a t-shirt for an opposing team. And these people who have never met this man before are are getting really agitated at his mere presence. That's stereotype leading to prejudice. He then goes and does this gator chomp thing. He seems to be reveling in this negativity he's created. And then they really let loose on him. And the people behind me say he's going to get his ass kicked. And he'll deserve it too. Now keep that in mind. He's going to get his ass kicked and he'll deserve it. What they are doing now, they've gone from peaceful, sports-loving people to advocating violence against a man who wore a t-shirt and did this. They're not going to go down and commit the violence, but if somebody else did it, they'd go, oh, well, you know, that's what you get for being them in the wrong place at the wrong time and being proud of being them. It's that pervasive. It's religion against religion. It's country against country. It's race against race. It's men against women. It's old against young. It's every label you can apply and form an in-group with against all the other labels who represent out-groups. That then can lead to discrimination. Prejudice is an attitude. Discrimination is an action. It's an attitude made manifest in a behavior that in some way is negative or harmful towards a member of a group because they're a member of that group. That's key. Now, in olden days, which aren't that old, people wearing their racial prejudices on their sleeves in America were very common. And I don't like to hear the term reverse racism, because racism is just racism. Do some white people hate black people? Yes, they do. Do some black people hate white people? Yes, they do. Do some blacks hate Hispanics? Yes. Do some Hispanics hate whites? Yes. You name the group. Do some Protestants hate Catholics? Just go to Ireland. Do some group of people hate some other group of people? Absolutely. Be real clear on this. I'm not talking about just race in America. It's just a very convenient example of a worldwide human phenomenon, right? When you look at this now, people today don't wear their racial prejudices on their sleeve very often because it's become politically incorrect. It doesn't mean that they've gone away. Racism that has been institutionalized doesn't just disappear. Sexism that's been institutionalized doesn't just disappear. Ageism that's been institutionalized doesn't just disappear. Religious prejudices that are institutionalized don't just disappear. There is actually a clause in the Tennessee State Constitution that says an atheist may not hold office in Tennessee. That's a category of person who is now not allowed to participate in civil governance because of their label. It's codified. That's the point here. So anytime we are behaving in a negative way towards somebody overtly, it's easy to see that it is based on prejudice. But what if we do it covertly? What if we even do it without being aware that we're doing it? Could we possibly behave in a way that we weren't aware of? Well, Freud said we do it all the time. And I told you before, Freud is hard to operationalize. Freud is hard to get a hold of, because how do you make that manifest? How do you show that people aren't aware of the driving forces of their own behaviors? Well, there's a whole host of research in this domain that shows it. And I'm going to get to an example of that. Another application of this is the just world hypothesis, or the just world belief, which allows us to derogate, to put down victims, people who are victims of crimes or situations, by blaming them because in a just world, good people have good things happen to them. Bad people have bad things happen to them. And we all have this belief that this world is, on the whole, probably just. And that if something bad happened to you, and I don't know anything about you, it must be because you deserved it in some way. Somehow. You look back at mental illness and we'll see that it was considered to be a demon possession. Well, you must have offended God, or you must have invoked the devil. You must have deserved that. And you see it today in rape victims. The first thing a lot of people say, well, what was she wearing? It doesn't matter what she was wearing. Well, was she drunk? It doesn't matter if she was drunk. Those are ways to say, how was she a bad person that deserved to be raped? And nobody deserves to be raped. It's a human cognitive process that allows us to correct an injustice in the world by just believing that somehow the victim deserved it. And if we have prejudices, they may or may not be manifest into behaviors, but sometimes they are. And this is a study that I just want to give you an example of this. So this is a common thing in America, is race relations can be tense. Again, the world over, there are tribes that fight tribes in Africa. There are Catholics who fight Protestants in Ireland. People who homogeneously or appear homogeneous in terms of their skin tone still have in-groups and out-groups. And this is not a black-white thing, but this is a way of demonstrating how implicit prejudice can result in discrimination. So looking at pre-interview racial bias, white sales managers evaluated the resumes of either a white or African-American applicant for a sales position. Now, how do you know if they're white or African-American? These resumes are identical. They're identical resumes that people have never met these quote-unquote applicants. They're being asked to evaluate what they think is just a random resume. The only difference is the name on the resume. It's either a quote-unquote African-American sounding name or a white sounding name. Males, in this case, because you add in females and that adds in another little layer of complexity. Right? What's an African-American sounding name? They did some pre-testing. They tested names and had people rate whether it sounded white or whether it sounded African-American, and they used the ones that were most reliably categorized as one or the other. They were making these labels stick. They were using the stereotypes for the express purpose of seeing whether people have their stereotypes and prejudices activated by simple name change. That's it. So you have these objectively very, very good resumes. And here, in short, is the result. We have a low accountability group in the dotted line, and we have a high accountability group in the straight line, this undotted line right here. The high accountability group, nobody is told what this purpose is. They just think that they're reviewing resumes. They have no idea what's really going on. They're managers. They do this all the time. And in the low accountability group, they're just doing that. In the high accountability group, they're told that somebody will come along and review their choice and see how they made their choices, right? They don't say anything about race or anything like that. They're just going to talk to you about how you made your decisions so they could better understand how people evaluate resumes. It seems pretty innocuous and doesn't seem like it would have any effect whatsoever. But they call that the high accountability group because somebody's going to hold you accountable for the rating you made. The low accountability group, you just make a rating. And this is what emerges. In the low accountability group, the white sounding applicant rates at 4.85. That's 97%. You can't get much higher than a 4.85 at 97% of out of five. So you look at a 5-point scale, it's very hard to convert that in your mind to what's the meaning of that. That's pretty high. It doesn't get much higher than 4.85. In other words, this must be an awesome resume. But look in the same group what the African-American sounding name gets as a score. A 4.12. A 4.12 and a 4.85, they're both over 4. Does that really matter? Well, it really does matter. That's almost 15 percentage points different. And the only difference is the name on the application. Now, if you ask these people, are they racist? They probably would say, of course not. Why would I let that even enter my mind? I would only evaluate a candidate on their qualifications. They don't know what's happening here. They're unaware of the research paradigm. If you ask them if they're racist, most of them would probably say, no, of course not. I'm not racist. But that's the whole point. If you don't admit to yourself that you have stereotypes, that you have schemas, that you have biases, you'll never even really be able to work on them. And they exist, and they can cause actual real-world damage. And again, 4.12, is that really any different? Yeah. You think about a job with 100 applicants, and somebody scores 15% higher than another person. Who's going to get the job? Who's going to get the interview? There it is, right there, in black and white, no pun intended. That's a huge difference based nothing upon a name. It's a reliable difference. It's an average of many ratings, so we have confidence in it, and it's been replicated many times. It's also been replicated with other race groups. It's also been replicated with sex, male and female. These things happen. Check out the high accountability group, though. This is fascinating to me. In the high accountability group, where all they know is that somebody's going to check my ratings later, they don't give the African-American a giant boost, but they give them a boost. It actually goes up. It goes up to 4.35. But what happens now is also fascinating. Becoming aware that somebody else is going to review what you did. The white applicant's, that white sounding name evaluation goes down, way down to 4.12. These people don't know what's going on. They don't know that they did that because they're not connected to all the other people in the study. What you just see is a correction of a racial prejudice, probably because people don't want to see themselves as prejudiced, and they've made a course correction, which is maybe more likely to be the quality of the application. If we average this and that, that's probably the real quality. Without any accountability, it was inflated. But with accountability, it was deflated, maybe more than it should have been. This one was inflated, but maybe as it should have been. Right? So you see that this is an insidious process that happens between in-groups and out-groups, has eternally happened since human beings have come about, and unless we do something, will continue to happen. But your education puts you in a position to help correct these issues, and the first correction should start with ourselves. I'm a person with biases and schemas that aren't valid, but I know that, and I check that against reality as often as I can, and I try not to be a cognitive miser. I try to think about it deeply, and I try to be willing to change.